Oh, yes, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Well, I want to thank the Lewises. I know that you had some technical problems and things went back and forth, but you hung right in there, and God bless. And Minister Lewis, I want you to know, I was on early to hear. It's another Sunday morning. I love hearing when you say it, so it is that. You know, we started the series of teaching, and let me remind you, because it's so important, this is the year of spiritual obedience. Every one of the teachings the Lord has been giving me throughout this year, from January to this point here, has been related to that aspect of our life, of our spiritual life. Because we see and we know through the word that obedience is better than sacrifice. And we find out that through this word of our state of obedience is where those blessings will overtake us. Where these blessings will enter into our lives and do what it does best. Where these blessings, the covenant that God gives those who trust and believe in him, are at presence. And this is the year. You know, sometimes, you know, we can't chastise. We can't resent the chastisement of God correcting us in areas of our life, because he wants to enhance us to receive those promises even in a more abundancy if we can trust him. Sometimes we have to get away with the old in order for the new to come in. Sometimes we try to hold on to old that keeps and hinders the new from coming in. And we have to take inventory of that, brothers and sisters. This is why these teachings are so important. This is why those Bible studies, where we get to interact and begin to exchange the thoughts and the spiritual thoughts between us. Oh, those, I don't want to call them debate session, but they're iron sharpening iron about some of this, the talk we have at these various Bible studies on Tuesday. You're missing out. I'm telling you, the pastor right there, and we're listening to the other ministers and other people that are participating. And I tell you what, I'm growing. Dr. Larry L. Lockley is growing, hearing the various anointings, the various paradigms. And that's what's all important to me in ministry. You know, the old cliche, seek first to understand before trying to be understood. And sometimes it helps me locate where people are and where I am in this world. And you need to locate where you really are. If things are not happening the way they're supposed to, you've got to ask yourself, it can't be God, because he watches over his word to perform it. So it must be with you. So we have to take inventory. Last week we started the series, and the teaching was, are you truly willing and obedient to adhere to God's word? That was part one. We're going to finish that with part two. And I would think about this topic, now, what the title says, are you truly willing and obedient to adhere to God's word? We talked about how even as young kids we used to walk away stomping when we were told to do things that we didn't want to do, because it interfered with what our flesh wanted to do at that time. Well, that transcended to some of us in adults and some of us who are now born again Christian. Even though we're supposed to be born again, old things would be passed away and old things become new. But we still have that attitude of something we don't like, of something that kind of disturbs us. And God, we know God, because my sheep know my voice, that God is telling us to do. We still walk away in a state of doing it, but yet we're still grumbling while we're doing it. Therefore, it's really not in our heart for it to be executed the right way. Now, what do you think about that? You know, it's a part of not only hearing the word, but being able to execute it in a proper manner in which God wants to do. And I'm using this term because we're going to see this in time. Are you truly willing and obedient to adhere to what God is saying to you, or what God is telling you to do, or what God's word has told us? We started over here, and I'm going to go fast with this, Ray. We started over the book of Psalms, Psalms 143. Turn to the book of Psalms 143, just recap it a little bit. The 143rd division of Psalms. We looked at verse 10 and verse 11. And this is for all of us now, and I ask this is something I ask of God all the time, and you need to ask all the every day too. It says here in verse 10 on the 143rd division of Psalm, it says, teach me to do thy will, for thou art my God. Well, that's only appropriate if God is really your God and not something part-time. But see, if you're full-time God, you want him to teach. If you're missing it, you need for him to teach you, because he's the only one to teach you what he really wants you to do. It says, teach me to do thy will, for thou art my God. Now, line that, thou art my God. Thy spirit is good. Lead me into the land of uprightness. That's righteousness. Verse 11 says, quicken me, which means make alive, O Lord, for thy name's sake, for thy righteous sake, bring my soul out of trouble, my mind, my will, and my emotion. Let me read that from the Amplified. Verse 10, and after that, teach me to do your will, for you are my God. Let your good spirit lead me into a level country and into the land of uprightness. Verse 11, Amplified, save my life, it starts out, O Lord, for your name's sake, in your righteousness, bring my life out of trouble and free me from distresses. Do you relate to that? Do you relate to that? Verse 12 over it, and the King James says, and of thy mercies cut off mine enemies and destroy all them that afflict my soul, my mind, my will, and my emotion, for I am thy servant. Are you? For I am that servant. Boy, I tell you, those three verses are teaching within itself here. But you want you to, in order for somebody to teach you, you got to want to be taught. There are some areas we don't want to be taught, but we already have the answer for it. Just ask us. And that's part of the challenge for some people in their line and their road to obedience. You know, it's a difference between you obey and being obedient. Obey is an act. Obedience is a lifestyle. And the challenge we look at, you never hear people saying these kids, they're dogs or animals, and I use that term not really to you as an animal, but I'm just using it as an analogy, is that they don't send them to obey school, they send them to obedience school because they want it to be ongoing. Your life should be an ongoing state of adhering, not just hearing, adhering to God's word. Now, let's get back to the topic here and over the book of Isaiah. Isaiah, first chapter of Isaiah. And y'all forgive me if I keep drinking because I got a little dry throat this morning. Listen to those praise songs. They kind of have you making melody right there. One of the things that as I begin to read in the first chapter of Isaiah, and I want to begin around verse 10. And we talked about this last week, and I'm just trying to recap it here because I need to get to some other scriptures here. It says, hear the word of the Lord, ye rulers of Solomon. Give ear unto the law of our God, ye people of Gomorrah. Now, let's read the Amplified, because I want you to hear what it's saying here right now. It says, hear, this Amplified, hear, O Jerusalem, the word of the Lord, you rulers or judges of another Solomon. Sodom. Give ear to the law and the teaching of our God, you people of another Gomorrah. In other words, he's saying, you all in your lifestyle, we all in our lifestyle are trying to reenact the very cities, the very spirit that he had to destroy. We find that in today's challenges, that we find that there are people right now, there are laws right now, there are spirits right now that's trying to bring back Sodom and Gomorrah with all the in-depthness of some of the spiritual and physical challenges that people went through and thought it was all right, thought it was righteous in the eyes of the Lord. We see that today. There was a term that we use, you know, people, they're trying to do things that politically correct. Let me tell you something. If it's not spiritually correct, you need to let it go, believer. The challenge is we have to walk by faith. And our faith is based on the principles that God has given us to obey. And we find this world right now is changing God's word for its own fleshly sake. You got to call it like it is. Because see, if these things, if these challenges are hitting your blessings, you need to walk away from them. You don't need to be a part of that. You need to let that go. Let's finish this out here. Let me see here now. It goes on, it says, verse 11, to what purpose is the multitude of your sacrifices unto me, said the Lord? I am full of the burnt offerings unto me, said the Lord. I am full of the burnt offerings of rams and of the fat of fed beasts, and I delight not in the blood of bullocks or lambs, or any goats. In other words, God telling me, why are you bringing me all this stuff here? And yet it's still, you're doing what you want to do. Let me read the Amplified so you can understand. It says, to what purpose is the multitude of your sacrifices to me unless they are the offerings of the heart? Says the Lord. I have had enough of the burnt offerings of rams and the fat of red beasts without obedience. You're giving me this stuff, but yet still you're not adhering to my words, he's saying. And I do not delight in the blood of burnt of bulls or of lambs or of he-goats without righteousness. In other words, God's saying, you're trying to bribe me with the things you're bringing and thinking I'm going to adhere to them, but your heart is far from you. Well, so that's a scripture. You honor me with your lips, but your heart is still far from you. What do you mean? That you're not doing what I'm asking you to do, but you think that I would overlook what you're not doing because you can bring these little tricklets of burnt offerings as if I need them. I don't need them. I'm looking for your heart. I'm looking for your obedience. You know, if I can remember, I think you had a whole lot of angels, starting with one by the name of Lucifer, got kicked out because of disobedience, of trying to do their own thing and not adhere to the rules that God had laid out before them. They could not reside in heaven. So how do you expect for you to be able to receive the promises of God? God says that he don't cast his pearls to the swine, because he tells us not to cast our pearls to the swine. But yet it's still, through disobedience, you want God still to present those promises and give those promises to you when you're still walking in unrighteousness in his eyes, because you're not doing what he's asking you to do. Help me with this, brothers and sisters. He's saying here, dog, you can't bribe me. I can't be bought. I'm watching what you're doing. You're not listening to me. You're not adhering to me. You think that you can bring these things. You think you can do these things. And they're supposed to be one of the things where I can just turn my eyes and look at a different. No. God cannot be bought. It goes on, it says here, verse 13, bring no more, underline this now, King James, bring no more vain oblations. Incense is an abomination unto me, the new moon and Sabbath, the calling of assemblies, I cannot sway you. It is iniquity, even the solemn meetings. Even when you come to me, I don't want to deal with it here. Amplified says, bring no more offerings or vanity, emptiness, vainglory, and futility. Your hollow offerings of incense is an abomination to me. The new moon and Sabbath, the calling of assemblies, I cannot endure it. It is iniquity and profanation, even in the solemn meetings. In other words, you all this show, it don't mean nothing to me, because I know your heart. You're not obeying me. You think you just can persuade me to overlook those things. He's talking to his people here now. It says, verse 14, King James, your new moons and your appointed feasts, my soul hateth. They are troubled unto me. I am weary to hear them. Verse 15, and when you spread forth your hands, oh, that's the real, you got to underline this whole verse here. And when you spread forth your hands, I will hide my eyes from you. Yea, when you make many prayers, I will not hear. Your hands are full of blood. Let me read the Amplified for that. And when you spread forth your hands in prayer, imploring help, I will hide my eyes from you. Even though you make many prayers, I will not hear. Your hands are full of blood. Boy, would you want the Father to have a deaf ear to your prayers, especially in your time of trouble, even when you're trying to so-called repent? Oh, brothers and sisters, we serve a righteous God. And it may not seem righteous in your eyes, but if everyone has done everything that they can do for you, and you still turn your back to them, what is it supposed to do? I'm talking to the believers today. You know, this is not Burger King when in the kingdom of God. You can't have it your way. It has to be God's way or no way. It says here in verse 16, wash your hands. Now, this is God's response. This is what God is saying, that you've done all this, and I can't go along with it. But here's what you need to do. Let's start at verse 16. It says, wash you, make you clean, put away the evil of your doings from before my eyes. Cease to do evil. Is that asking a lot? Or has your flesh overcome you, overtaken you so much that it's hard for you to let go of some of the stuff that you know are not pleasing in the eyes of God? Your thoughts are not his thoughts, and his ways, your ways are not his ways. When you say that word wash you, the only way you can wash and be cleansed is through God's word. That's why Bible studies are so important, brothers and sisters. If you need to know that you know that you know, if you want God to teach you, you've got to get into his word. It says here in verse 17, it says, it's God still talking, learn to do well. Seek judgment. Relieve the oppressed. Judge the fatherless. Plead for the widow. Verse 18 says, come now and let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sin be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. Here's the key to it. Look what verse 19 says. If ye be willing and obedient, ye shall eat the good of the land. How are you eating right now? Are you just eating leftovers? Or are you eating first cut class stuff? How's your life? You've got to say, wait a minute, if Jesus come to give me life and give it to me more abundantly, how come I'm not living an abundant life? It says God watches over his word to perform it. Did he miss me? Or did I miss it? You see, that obedience, without that willing to become obedient, God looks at the heart. And the thing about it, we have to guard. The Bible says we have to guard our heart. Right now, there's probably some things happening in your life that you're trying to find out why. Did you check your obedient calendar? Did you check and say, well, I didn't feel like doing this. I didn't want to do that. Oh, I didn't like that. He don't require all that from me. If he didn't, he wouldn't have wrote it down. To whom much is given, I read, much is also required. So if you're asking for a lot of this stuff without the requirement of trying to fulfill the requirement to receive it, you know, it doesn't work. The last time I had to think of it, this is the year of graduation, and there are certain requirements in order for those graduates to receive those diplomas or those degrees. When you meet those requirements based on what that the school or the state or whatever they require, then they're obligated to give you what's rightfully yours. It's the same thing in this word. God says he watches over his word to perform it, but it's based on you adhering to what he's telling you and us to do. One thing about God, he doesn't compromise. He said, I change not. Brothers, I want you to receive these blessings. Sisters, I want you to receive these blessings. This is the year of spiritual obedience. When do we start? When do you start putting your stuff on the back burner and putting God's stuff on the front burner? When do you begin to hear God and stop hearing these other voices around you thinking they can accomplish more for you than God can? They can't. They can't. Their stuff is temporary. Because God can dry it up at any minute. But God's stuff, what God presents, is continuous. Oh, I've got to preach today, brothers and sisters, because number one, your blessings. God's promises is in a state at your life. That's what's at stake right now. God promises, and you receive them into your life. Verse 18, come now and let us reason together, said the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. If you be willing and obedient, you shall eat the good of the land. Verse 20, underline this. But if you refuse and rebel, ye shall be devoured with the sword, for the mouth of the Lord hath spoken it. Verse 21, how is the faithful city become an harlot? It was full of judgment, righteousness, logged in it, but now murderous. When you first came to the Lord, when you first became born again, the church doors were not open long enough. You wanted church about 7 days a week, 24/7. But yet it's still, it seems that you've allowed yourself to get pulled back into the world. We all get pulled back into the world and forget the promises that God made to us and that we made to Him. And we find ourselves, rather than adhering to what God told us to do, we begin to push them to the side because we allow more worldly stuff to enter in and forget about the thing that got us to a place of total salvation with the Lord. What place is that? That place called there. That place, you know, that passive, that peace that passes all understanding. That place called there. Are you there? Yeah? Are you there? You know, I use this term in different teaching, but one of my friends and I, we were talking about these various cruises, and one of these commercials said that if you take this particular cruise line, you'll find yourself spending more time being there than getting there. We have too many believers spending time of trying to get to the place called there in their life with God, rather than being there because of disobedience. You need to spend less time trying to get there by becoming obedient to God's word and spend more time being there and enjoying the blessing that God has for each and every one of us who's willing to be willing and obedient and adherent to His word. Oh, verse 20, but if you refuse to rebel, you shall be devoured with the sword, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. How is the faithful city become a harlot? It was full of judgment, righteousness, lodged in it, but now murderous. Thy silver, verse 22, thou silver has become dressed, thy wine mixed with water. Thy princes are rebellious and companions of thieves. Everyone love of gifts and follow after, oh my goodness, rewards. They judge not the fathers, neither do they cause of the widows to come unto them. Let me read that from the Amplified. Your princes are rebels and companions of thieves. Everyone love bribes and run after compensation and reward. They judge not for the fathers, nor defend them, neither does the cause of the widow come to them, but they delay or a him a deaf ear. In other words, you spend more time trying to get yourself compensated, get yourself reward, and don't matter who you step on or who you defile to get it. Is that where you are today? Or are you willing to stand on God's word and watch the rightful compensation come your way? You know, are you easily bribed as a believer? Are you easily bribed to do what the world telling you to do versus what God is saying for you to do? Are you willing to sacrifice your soul, your place in heaven, for what somebody's telling you you need to do here on the earth? Brothers and sisters, I'm here to tell you as a pastor, as a minister, and as a believer, hell is real. Hell is real. And the worst time to find out is when you get there. You don't need to be there to find out it's real. I would have gone to the end. But the challenge begins right now in a state of obedience with the Lord. Oh, I know this sounds rough for you today, but sometimes we've got to be shaken up to realize what's hindering us from being at that place called there. We're spending too much time trying to get there rather than being there, as that commercial said. Oh, we're cruising this life, brothers and sisters, but I want to be in that place, that land filled with milk and honey, where the peace that passes all understanding is a daily life. That's where I want to be. Yeah. You say, well, that's heaven. No, that's going to be your heaven right here on earth. Verse 24 says, therefore said the Lord of hosts, the mighty one of Israel, I would ease me of my adversaries and avenge me of my enemies. God would do that for you. And I would turn my hand upon thee and purely purge away the dress and take away all the tin. And I will restore the judges at the first and thy counselors at the beginning. After thou shalt be called the city of righteousness, the faithful city, God will give you your own city that you live in. Those people on the outside of that city, God won't allow them into your life. God won't allow them to perpetrate into your life. God would keep you in a city full of righteousness. The people God would send you around, the things God would bring to you, you won't worry about what's going out there because you will be living in a city of righteousness before God. God will stop the enemy at the door. God will allow the darkness to perpetrate in your life. God will make sure that you have more than you need. You're supplied with more than you need. God will bring that abundance in. But that's based on your state of willing to be obedient and adhere to His word. Oh, goodness. 27, verse 27, Zion shall be redeemed with judgment, and her converts and with righteousness. And the destruction of the transgressors and of the sinners shall be together, and they that forsake the Lord shall be consumed. Verse 29, but they shall be ashamed of the oaths which you have desired, and ye shall be confounded by the garden that you have chosen. But ye shall be as an oak whose leaf fadeth, and the garden that has no water. And the wrong shall be to be as a tow, and the maker as a spark, and they shall both burn together, and none shall quench. Brothers and sisters, it's your time. It's our time. I'm going to close with a couple of verses right here. Turn to the book of Hebrews. Book of Hebrews. 10th chapter. You know these scriptures, but I just want you to get there just to remind you. Hebrews chapter 10. Oh, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Hebrews chapter 10. Go down to verse 22. Well, let's start at verse 21. The Word of God reads and says, Hebrews chapter 10, verse 21 says, and having a high priest over the house of God. Our high priest is Jesus, the name above all names. J-E-S-U-S, the name of God. That's our high priest. It says, and having a high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart. That's a heart willing to do what God's telling us to do when He's telling us to do it. It says, in full assurance of faith. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, but it's the evidence of things not seen. The assurance that God is able to perform what He says He's going to do. Look what it says here. Having, let us draw near with a true heart and full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Verse 23 says, let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering. For He is faithful, that promise. This is what God tells us to do. God is faithful. You may not be faithful, but God is faithful. I tell you what, drop down to verse 35. Oh, yes, Lord, yes, Lord. It says, cast not away, therefore, your confidence, but you have great recompense of reward. Don't start out in faith and end up in the flesh. Don't cast away what you started with. If you're starting in faith, stay in faith. Verse 36, for you have need of patience. God tells us in the Word, we don't grow weary of what I'm doing. We hang right in there. I don't want you to hang. I want you to stand. When you've done all you do, stand. It says, for we have need of patience, that after we have done the will of God, ye might receive the promise. And patience at its perfect work, brothers and sisters. It may seem longer than natural, but let me tell you this. Sometimes we've gotten ourselves in a lot of stuff that it took a short time to get us in, but it may take us a long time to get us out based on the things God has to straighten up to make sure everything's all in place in your life. Be patient. Knowing God is the one who's correcting. It says, for yet a little while, verse 37, for yet a little while, he that shall come will come and will not tarry. Verse 38, now the just, underline it, now the just shall live by faith. But if any man or woman draw back, my soul shall have no pleasure in them. But we are not of them who draw back unto perdition, but of them that believe to the saving of our soul. Brothers and sisters, I know that the pastor probably stepped on some toes, but the toes probably needed stepping on.
Gracious Lord,
we need to be led by the Spirit of God.
Take my hand.
We need to let God guide us no matter what.
Lead me on.
He loves us. He's our guide. He's our director.
Let me stand.
But we've got to trust him.
All
God loves you, brothers and sisters.
Time.
But don't grow weary.
All
he is there. He's the God of the living. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord. Listen, let's go and pray. We're not going to let the devil rob this. Oh, precious Lord. Take our hands, Father. Help us in despite, or despite of the challenges that's trying to come towards us. Help us to realize that the blessing. Yes. Father God, in the name of Jesus, allow your word. Father God, in the name of Jesus, allow your word to come forth. We know the enemy is challenging us right now, but he's a liar. We know that these things coming from the word check, even the blanking out of us trying to relate to each other. Those of you who are able to hear, just reach back into the Zoom. The devil is a liar. We won't let him allow him to rob us of what's really ours. We won't allow the challenges to hinder us from receiving God's blessing in our life. We're asking you, Father, to take each and every one of our hands right now. Guide us, direct us, bring us back into the valley of peace, of love, and understanding. Help us to realize we're special because we're yours. We're yours, children of obedience, children who adhere to what you're saying. Children are willing to follow you no matter what. Oh, we don't walk by sight. We walk by faith. And we're allowing that faith to take us where we need to be. And that's in your presence. Take our hands, Father. Take our hands, Father. Oh, precious Lord. Lead us. Guide us. Direct us. We love you, Father. Oh, I thank you, Father. I praise you, Father. I give you all the glory right now, Father. Oh, yes, yes, yes. We praise you. We thank you. And we count these things done. In your most precious name, Jesus' name, let the church say, amen.